Good morning, everyone, and welcome to our worship service this morning at Covenant Church. We are grateful that you've joined us, and we pray that today, as we come before our great God, that you would feel his presence and his spirit moving in your heart. Hear these words from Psalm 95 as our call to worship this morning. For the Lord is the great God, the great King above all gods. In his hand are the depths of the earth, and the mountain peaks belong to him. The sea is his, for he made it, and his hands formed the dry land. Come, let us bow down in worship. Let us kneel before the Lord our Maker, for he is our God, and we are the people of his pasture, the flock under his care. The Lord watches over us and guides us. He is the great God above all things. Let's join our hearts in worship this morning.
Thank you. Good morning, boys and girls. I brought my wallet with me this morning. Do any of you have a wallet or a purse? What do you keep in it? Do you keep money in it? I have some money in here I want to show you. Let's see. I have a $1 bill. Can you see that? $1 bill. I wonder what I could buy with that dollar bill. Maybe some candy? What would you buy with a $1 bill? Let's see. Here's another $1 bill. See that? There's my $1 bill. Maybe this one could buy me some more candy. Here's another dollar bill. Well, that looks pretty similar to this one, doesn't it? Do you think if I brought these to the store, they would take all three of these? Then I could have $3 worth of candy. That would be great. But they all look a little bit different, don't they? So if I look a little closer at these dollar bills, this one says Monopoly on it. And it's a different color than these two, isn't it? It's white, and these are green. It says one, but it actually doesn't say anything about a dollar, and there's nothing on the back. Do you think they would take that one at the store? Probably not, would they? Okay, well, I guess I'm down to $2. But I still have these. These are really similar. They're both green. They both have a back on them. They look the same. This one says the United States of America. This one says the United States of America. Let's see. On the front, they both have a picture of George Washington. That's good. Federal Reserve note, they both say. So I guess I still have $2, right? $2. Wait a minute. This one's a little bit bigger than this one. Yep, definitely bigger. I've never had that before. Most of my money's all the same size. So maybe one of these is a fake. How can I tell? What do you think? Let's see. This one feels nice and thick. It's got a little bit of texture to it. If I hold it up to the light, Well, let's look at this one instead. This one has, just a minute. It's not two-sided after all. It's two pieces of paper taped together. Oh, no. Well, they're not going to take this one either, are they? Because most money does not rip in two pieces like that. Maybe if I stuck it back together, do you think they'd still take it? No. I think someone at the bank or the store would know that it was a fake, wouldn't they? How would they know it was a fake? Do people give them this kind of money all the time? Probably not. I think that they can tell it was a fake because they've seen the real one so often. Every single day, people come in with actual money, with a real dollar bill. And I think someone could tell if this one is a fake and this one is the real one. So, well, now I'm down to only $1. But you know what? This dollar is actually worth something, isn't it? Those two weren't worth anything to begin with. Well, people can tell that this is a real one because they've handled the real one so often. And then they can tell that those are a fake because they're not like the real ones. That reminds me of a word that Pastor Doug is going to talk about this morning. That word is discernment. That's kind of a big word, isn't it? That word means kind of being able to tell the truth from a lie, real from a fake, right versus wrong, the direction that we should go. That's kind of what that big word discernment means. And this morning, Pastor Doug's going to talk about how we can tell what God has to say to us. How do you think we could tell what God really has to say? One of the very best ways I know is in His Word. If we know the God of the Bible and what He really does, who He really is, then we can tell when something that we're considering doesn't line up with what God would really want. When we can hear God's voice, either through the Bible or through prayer or through wise counsel from someone else, then we know that that is what God is saying and not what our brains are coming up with. So I want to challenge you this week to practice hearing what God has to say. You can practice by learning more about him in the Bible, learning who he is. You can practice by praying and by really considering choices to know whether that is what God has to say and what God wants you to do. So that big word, discernment, is what we'll be learning about today. Listen as Pastor Doug has more to say about that in a few minutes. Have a good week, everyone.
All right. Good morning, Covenant Church. It's good to be with you again this Sunday morning. We're going to spend some time in prayer, and the prayer I'm going to pray today is based on Psalm 33. So let's spend some time in prayer together. Father in heaven, we come before you now in a time of corporate prayer. And as we pray, we begin with prayers of praise to you. We praise you with song. We sing for joy to the Lord. We sing a new song of praise to you, for you are our God. You are the creator of the heavens and the earth. You spoke and the heavens were created. You breathed the word and all the stars were born. You are the one who assigned the sea and its boundaries. You locked the oceans in vast reservoirs. You formed the mountains and the dry land. You made the flowers, the trees, the birds, the lakes, the fish, the sandy beaches, all the things that we enjoy during these summer months. We praise you because you created all these things. And we stand in awe of all that you have made. We praise you too for who you are. Your righteousness is like the mighty mountains. Your justice like the ocean depths. You care for people and animals alike, O Lord. Lord, you look down from heaven and see the whole human race. From your throne, Lord, you observe all who live on the earth. You made each of our hearts, so you understand everything that we do, everything that we are dealing with, everything that troubles our hearts. You are a God who is acquainted with our suffering and familiar with our grief. So this morning we open once again and lift up our hearts and the hearts of those around us to you right now. We pray for those we know who are sick or who are hurting, or those we know who need physical healing. We continue to pray for Jerry and Jan and for Gloriana. And we thank you for the healing that they've received thus far. And we just pray for continued healing. We pray too for any others that we know of today who need healing and that we name out loud before you right now. We pray for those whose hearts are filled with grief today as they mourn the death of someone they love. We pray for Dory and the Harima family as they grieve the death of a father and grandfather. And we pray for Jay and the Morin family as they grieve the death of Jay's sister. Be near to them. Encourage them with your spirit. Comfort them. We pray too for any others that we know of who are grieving today as we name them before you out loud right now. We also pray with those who are dealing with mental illness and those who care for them. We pray for those who are unemployed or underemployed during this season and are dealing with financial challenges as a result. We pray for those who are dealing with an addiction of any kind, whether it be to substances or work, technology, pornography, or something else. We pray too for those who support them and are affected by these addictions. We also pray for those we know, family members, friends, neighbors and coworkers who do not yet have faith in you, Jesus. On this holiday weekend, when we remember and celebrate our country, the psalmist reminds us that blessed is the nation whose God is the Lord. And while many in our country know and trust you, God, as their Lord and Savior, we are aware that many others have not yet put their hope and trust in you. So we cry out and we pray for them today. We pray that you would soften their hearts, God. We pray that you would reveal and make yourself known to them. And we pray that you would use each one of us in any way needed to help them find and experience faith in you. Father in heaven, the psalmist reminds us that the things of this world cannot save us. Our physical strength cannot save us. Our intellect and our smarts cannot save us. Only you can save us, God. Only your unfailing love and grace and mercy can save us. Only you can rescue us from death, and only you can keep us alive in the midst of pandemic and unrest. So today we pray and we renew and put our trust in you. Today we renew and put our hope in you, Lord. As we take our summer family vacations and explore different places, as we participate in summer training for our school sports teams, as we go to work each day and then to the lake or beach when we're finished, as we tend our gardens and lawns and do chores around the house, as we do all these things, Lord, we acknowledge that you, God, are our help and our shield. And we declare that your plans, plans to prosper and not to harm, plans to give hope and a future, we declare that your plans are what stands firm forever. So as we continue to worship you now by turning our attention to your word, we pray that you would open our hearts and lives to your word today. As we sing and pray the song, Speak, O Lord, use this sung prayer to prepare us to hear what Pastor Doug has to share with us this morning from your word. And we pray all these things in the name of Jesus, our Savior and Lord, and everyone said, Amen.
Good morning. Greetings to those of you who are in your homes. Greetings to those who this weekend might be at your cottage or in your camper. Good morning to those of you who are in your backyard, on your driveway, that are even with other members of your small group. And good morning to those of you who are worshiping in the worship center this morning. This morning we're going to continue our series on discovering God's will together. And we're entering into that four-part series where we're going to actually talk about discernment. And the text for this morning is somewhat familiar. It's from the prophecy of Jeremiah, the 29th chapter and the 11th verse. And Jeremiah writes, "For I know the plans that I have for you, declares the Lord, plans to prosper you and not to harm you, plans to give you hope and a future." So seeking God's will often seems as exclusive and elusive as seeking the Holy Grail. At times we seem to get so close, and at other times it seems way out of reach. Sometimes it appears that we have chosen just the right path, only to discover somehow things have gotten really, really messy. Discerning God's will takes considerable time and effort. It's the slow work of God. Beginning this morning and for the next three Sundays, we're going to specifically focus on how do we discern God's presence, His voice, and His will. Everything we've talked about in this series up until now has been absolutely essential, but preliminary. At this point, we're now prepared by having intentionally focused on deepening our relationship with God. We've underscored the need to spend time with Him in solitude and in silence, to be immersed in the Scripture every single day, to listen to God in prayer, to examine ourselves before Him, and to be increasingly self-aware. We've said that only those who have a growing relationship with God can ultimately recognize His voice. We've talked about how discernment is done best together and always promotes the unity of Christ's church. So having done that preparation, over the next few weeks we're going to discuss spiritual discernment, and then hopefully we'll be able to practice it together. So this morning we're going to address the prelude to discernment, and next week the process of discernment, followed by the pursuing discernment, and then finally the practice of discernment. While it's important for every believer to participate and practice discernment in his or own personal life, it's also critical for the church to practice discerning God's will together, because it's not our church, it's His church, and so His will is really the only one that matters. But before we dig in too deep, let's back up a step and try to define what discernment really is. So first, discernment is the practice of walking with God, that is, practicing His presence, discovering how He is at work in His world, how His divine wisdom, that is, His plan, is unfolding, and how He wills for us to participate personally and corporately. Discernment is the practice of looking for God everywhere. Discernment seeks to discover God wherever He is and to follow Him. Ignatius of Loyola, founder of the Jesuits, known for his spiritual discernment exercises, defines discernment as, and I quote, "finding God in all things in order that we might love and serve God in all things." So discernment is the intentional and increasingly attentiveness to and awareness of God's presence over time. It's the slow work of God. And that brings us to a growing sense of God's heart in our heart. Discernment is also the practice of listening to God everywhere. Christian discernment is built on listening to God through His Word, through Scripture, through our prayer time, in each other, which underscores the importance of community, and to God's Spirit as He moves in our heart. Listening is more important than talking. Or as somebody has pointed out, God gave us one mouth and two ears. Discernment is then paying attention to God and to God's work in His world and in our life. Second, discernment is the practice of distinguishing between two and sometimes more paths. Spiritual discernment is the process of distinguishing between good, that is, what is from God and draws us closer to Him, and what is evil, what is not from God and what separates us from Him. Most of us are already pretty good at that, not to say that we always do it. But discernment literally means to separate, to discriminate, to determine, to distinguish, to decide between two or more things. David Lonsdale identifies these two paths, saying one leads to fullness in life and the love of God, and the other ultimately to dehumanizing and destructive behavior. Spiritual discernment is the ability to distinguish between the path of our false self, that is, the self that is controlled by our own personal ego, and the path of the true self, that self that reflects God's love and God's grace. The deeper challenge of spiritual discernment is always to distinguish between something that might be good and we might enjoy, and the good that God is ultimately calling us to. If it's good, most of us just assume it's God, and God wants us to do it, even if God really wants us to do something a little bit different. And finally, or third, spiritual discernment is deciding to do what God is willing and calling us to do in ways that are always consistent with God's purpose and direction. Discernment, Paul says, is ultimately God working in us, enabling us to will and to act according to His purpose, Philippians 2. So after seeking God's perspective on ourselves and on our relationships and on our circumstances, the discernment isn't quite complete until we actually not only decide to do it, but actually go out and do it. The word discernment rarely appears in the Old Testament. And yet, story after story, as we read the stories of the Old Testament, finds individuals and entire communities making God-honoring choices together. Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, Moses, Sarah, Rachel, Leah, Hannah, Ruth, and Esther, just to name a few. Some in the Old Testament assign the role of discernment to a prophet, that is, God making His will known through them as they challenge God's people to be discerning. And there are a few Old Testament passages that specifically talk about the process of discernment. So Deuteronomy chapter 30, for example, verses 11, 14, and 19. Or 1 Samuel the 3rd chapter, verses 3 to 10. Or in 1 Kings 19, verse 12, Solomon asks God for wisdom, that is, literally for the opportunity to be discerning. In 1 Kings 3, 9, we read, "Give thy servant therefore an understanding mind, that I may be able to discern between good and evil." By contrast, in the New Testament, we find discernment all over the place. It's there over and over repeatedly. You see, Jesus already offers Himself as the object of discernment and the norm for all subsequent discernment from His believers and followers. When He asks, and when people ask in Mark 4, "Who is this man?" The discernment is always ultimately about Jesus, and it's explained for us by each gospel writer, as they discern what it means to live as Jesus lived and how Jesus calls us as His followers to live. In Galatians 5, Paul shares with us the fruits, that is, the evidence of discernment and obedience. Paul says believers are to receive the Holy Spirit in 1 Corinthians 12 that enables them to interpret and discern the entire Christian experience, 1 Corinthians 2. John, the apostle, sketches a basic theology of discernment in 1 John 4, the first few verses, talking about different spirits that exist and saying not all are holy, so they need to be tested and proven. And John says that's discernment, and it comes through the Holy Spirit, and it's manifest in our inner experience, that is, in and through our soul and our heart, as we come to know and to recognize God more and more clearly. The New Testament calls us to spiritual discernment, and it's addressed to every single believer. It is, as we talked last week, about the priesthood of every believer. Some faith communities tend to see discernment as the task and chrism of just leaders. And while that was the vision in the Qumran community, as we find expressed in the Deep Sea Scrolls, it's not the message of Jesus, nor is it the message of Paul or John. Their call to become mature friends is addressed to every believer of Jesus Christ. Leaders should discern how the Lord wishes them to live and to act and be a model for all believers. But all believers are encouraged and even commanded to become mature, responsible members of the body of Christ. We all need to discern the basic decisions of life in our own lives. For example, to marry or not marry. And if to marry, who we should marry. Children or no children. And if children, how many children. What our vocation ought to be. Where is God calling us in ministry? And the list is almost endless. Sadly, in our busyness, we have set aside and even lost the art of reflection and contemplation. We live often on autopilot. We make few well-discerned decisions, and we prioritize our own agendas. There are several prerequisites for discernment. Four. First, we need to have a desire to know God's will. Do we really want to know what God wants us to do? Second, we need the ability to hear God speak. Do you have a growing relationship with Jesus Christ? Third, do you have a commitment to actually do God's will, even before you know what it is? God says, first you promise to obey, and then I'll tell you what I want you to do. There's the Old Testament story about the priests standing at the side of the Jordan River, holding onto the ark, waiting for God to split it. And God says, no, that's not the way it works. First you step in, first you be obedient, and then I will split the sea. And the fourth is a conviction that God loves us and always has our very best interests at heart. That fourth prerequisite, an increasing confidence in the love that God has, enables us to trust God's intentions are always good, and that His will is always best, and that He has the power to carry that out in our lives. The second prerequisite, our ability to hear God, can be developed and fostered through spiritual direction, through mentoring, through practicing the disciplines, through being in the Word on a consistent basis, through being in prayer, and with persistent obedience. The first prerequisite, a deep desire to do God's will. We sort of assume that every believer has that. I mean, how can you really be a Christian if you're not really passionate about following Jesus? But it's that third prerequisite that gives most of us the most difficulty, and that is our commitment to obeying what God's will for us is, even before we know what it is. That's challenging. I mean, we're convinced that God is intelligent. He is most wise. We know that. And so we have this innate feeling that God then must agree with us on almost everything. Now, few people actually say it that bluntly, but it's amazing how my discernment of God's will almost always parallels exactly what I want it to be and parallels what I want to do. After all, I decided, I followed through on it, and God didn't strike me down with lightning. And I've actually had people tell me that on occasion. Many seemingly devout people who malign those who see things differently might say something like, anyone who doesn't agree with me and God because, you know, God and I agree must obviously be wrong. That person must be delusional, and that person probably isn't going to go to heaven either. To suggest obedience before we know what God is asking is both disconcerting and, for many of us, downright terrifying. I mean, what if I commit to doing something God wants me to do, and what God wants me to do is really repugnant? We tend to want first right of refusal. We want to bargain with God. I'm willing to do whatever you want, God, as long as it stays in my comfort zone, as long as you don't ask me to do something I really don't want to do. Problem is, that doesn't work with God. It's not an option. So who can effectively discern? Any believer. You and I. Anyone who is able to free themselves of personal attachments, of their own comfort system, of their own opinions, of their own desires, of their own agenda. That Saint Ignatius of Loyola, he says our whole spiritual struggle is to be free of disordered attachments in order that we might be truly free to follow the will of God. That's often called spiritual indifference. That is an attitude, a discipline of being indifferent to anything and everything except what is the will of God. Second, any believer who wants to know what God's will is can find it if they're passionate and disciplined in seeking it. And third, they can find it if they're committed to doing God's will by simply following Jesus' example. In the Garden of Gethsemane, Jesus clearly has his desires and his preferences, and he's in an intimate and passionate conversation with his Father. But in seeking and assessing his Father's will, Jesus once again comes to where we all need to be, and that is the painful dialogue that says, Father, it's not about my will. It's about yours. It's your will that needs to be done, and I will do it. Discernment is both a gift, a spiritual gift, and a mark of Christian maturity. Discernment is a gift because unless God is willing to share his will with us, we will be unable to discern it or know it. Paul lists discernment as a gift of the Spirit in 1 Corinthians 12. David Lonsdale says, discernment is one of those gifts that enables God's reign to be not only a dream, but a daily reality in our lives. The gift of discernment impacts our daily living, as well as our future destiny. Discernment is something that we need to consciously work hard at as well as receive as a gift. And so the question is, are we intentionally, are we continuously, are we conscientiously seeking God's will? Are we listening for Him to speak into our lives? Are we fully committed, once we hear His will, to follow it, to obey it, to do it, even if it wouldn't be our first choice? Paul in Romans 12 identifies the ability to discern the will of God as something that happens as the result of spiritual transformation. He says, be transformed, and then you will be able to test and approve what God's will is. John in 1 John 4, the first verse, instructs his readers, that is, growing Christian believers, to test the spirits to see which ones are from God and which ones aren't. Assuming that's something we are all capable of doing. So whether we feel gifted in this area or not gifted in this area, discernment, like for Christians, witnessing and being in the Scripture and prayer is not only an opportunity, it's a requirement, a responsibility for all who would seek Jesus. Two foundational truths about discernment. First, God loves to relate to us as mature believers. Thomas Green reminds us that God is neither a watchmaker nor a puppeteer, but the father of adult children. There are many believers that view God as a watchmaker. That is, a watchmaker understands that there is a precise place for every single part of the watch, And if in assembling it, one piece is out of place, the watch doesn't work. Likewise, they see that doing God's will is for people something that is so precise that there is one predetermined way to follow God's will. And if we get one thing wrong at any point, life won't work. There are other believers who view God more as a puppeteer. A puppeteer totally controls the puppets, and the puppet really has nothing to say about it. Likewise, some people view God as that puppeteer simply moving people around for his will. But Thomas Green suggests that we ought to think more about God as a great parent. When our children are small, we as parents tend to guide them through the dangers of life. We hold their hands walking across the street. We put things in the electric plug so they can't put their finger in. We put warm clothes on them on a cold day. We feed them nutritious food. And as they grow and as they learn, our hands-on guidance slowly decreases as well until they ultimately move out and have children of their own and establish their own lives. And now, for us as parents, as an empty nester, the primary role is to love and to support and to affirm them. In the parable of the prodigal son, Jesus says God is like a father. And he says, God, our Father, lets his son go off and waste his inheritance and longs for him to come back. And when he does, welcomes him. Was that the Father's will for his son? I doubt it. But the Father doesn't impose his will. And even though the son didn't make the choices the Father longed that he would, he always loved him. And he always wanted him to return home. And he was always ready to embrace him when he did. Discernment is our lifelong learning to be mature believers, to be adult children. Not forgetting the instructions that we have learned along the way about how to be more and more like Jesus. And second, God's will for us is pleasant. Like food that is actually good for us, we assume is actually going to taste awful. People often think that God's will is going to be hard and difficult and painful. At least it's not going to be something we really want or we really enjoy. Discernment becomes something we try to avoid as a result because we sort of assume if we really don't know what God's will is, then God can't hold us against it for not pursuing it. So discernment is something we think we have to sort of talk ourselves into. It's sort of something that is hard work, and so we ought to put it off to the side. Because we think that the choice is either between something we really want and we will really enjoy and something that God wants us to enjoy or like. But the possibility that God's will is something wonderful and aligns with our deepest desires is something that is ultimately true, even though it's foreign to most of us. And we need to change that understanding. Again, Ignatius of Loyola suggests that the ultimate sin is to refuse to believe that God wants us to be joyful and fulfilled and that he has a great plan for our life. And when we don't believe this, like Adam and Eve didn't believe it, then we're tempted to sin. Then we take things into our own hands and we do what we want to do instead of what God wants to do, and we pursue our own happiness at our ultimate expense. You see, the possibility that I might actually enjoy what God wants for me is radically different from what many people understand God's will to be. But it's true. The psalmist says it. Take delight in the Lord, and he will give you the desires of your heart. Or here in Jeremiah, the passage we read at the beginning of this message, I know the plans I have for you. They are plans to prosper you and not to harm you. They are plans to give you hope and a future. If we really believe that God has a better plan for our lives, then we would eagerly pursue that plan with all our heart, with all our soul, with all our mind, and with all our strength. That's the challenge. Now, when I've preached this series in the past, I've often had a reverse offering, and I've invited people to take a few pieces of puzzle and to take that puzzle and on a table in the narthex to put that puzzle together, because that is sort of a parable, if you will, sort of a metaphor for spiritual discernment and how we do it together. If we seek God with all our heart, God gives us some pieces of that puzzle. And when we pool what we're hearing from God together, we slowly begin to see what the puzzle is and how it takes form and what that looks like. And unfortunately, in this time that we're in, that doesn't work out real well for us. But the hope is that someday we'll still be able to do that together as a congregation and take that picture that we see in that puzzle as a reminder to seek God with all our heart, with all our soul, with all our mind, and with all our strength. Discerning God's will doesn't happen by accident or in a vacuum. It requires a community where new, growing, and maturing believers can experience God's word and spiritual transformation together. It requires a community engaged in the practices that bring us closer to Jesus. And when that happens, a spiritually discerning believer and a spiritually discerning church is born. Let's pray together. Father, we thank you that you have plans for us and that you're willing to share those plans if we ask. So, Father, we ask that you'll reveal your will to us as we seek your face and as we seek your hand. As we do that in our own personal life, but we also ask, Lord, that you would bless our endeavor to do that together as believers, as members of this congregation, that you might lead us where you would have us go, and that as we seek your face and seek your hand, your will would be clear. Bless us with the move of your Spirit, and we pray this in Christ's name. Amen.
Here we go. Third verse, same as the first. Intro, third verse, outro. Here we go.
So again, as this service comes to an end, as we take the prayers and the hymns and what we have heard from God and try to live it in our life, as we try to discern God's will for us and be obedient to it. God makes us a promise, and that is, He'll be there. He will never leave. He will give us His word. He will offer us His blessing, and He does that in these words. He says, the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make His face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn His face to you, and may you experience His never-ending peace. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Spirit, be blessed. Be safe. Go from this place and be His witnesses. In Christ's name, amen.